بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله العظيم من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهدي الله تعالى فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، له الملك وله الحمد، يحيي ويميت، وهو حي لا يموت، بيده الخير وهو على كل شيء قدير. وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله وصفيه وخليله، أدى الأمانة وبلغ الرسالة ونصح للأمة وكشف الغمة، وتركنا على المحجة البيضاء ليلها كنهارها لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك. فعليه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم، وعلى آله وصحبه ومن استنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين. اللهم اجعلنا منهم ومن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. آمين يا رب العالمين. وأوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله، وقد أمرنا بالحق، وقال تعالى: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. ثم أما بعد، we begin by praising our Lord سبحانه وتعالى, declaring his oneness and his right to be worshipped alone. And we bear witness that Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم is his final messenger. And we ask Allah to send his peace and blessings upon him, the one whom he sent as a mercy to all of the worlds. We ask Allah to be pleased with his companions and those that follow him and his example until the day of judgment. We ask Allah to make us amongst them. Allahumma ameen. Dear brothers and sisters, there is so much to say over a picture. And subhanAllah, these days we have extremely short-term memory. One day something goes viral, the next day we completely forget it. And it seems like over the last few years, that has been the case with Syria on a daily basis. One day they're there, one day they're not. One day it's the talk of the world, one day it's as if it doesn't exist anymore. One day everyone is crying for that Syrian child, the next day the world is speaking about them as if they are not even human beings. One day, there are calls for relief and charity and for people to come to their aid. The next day, we're back to our daily routines in which we are once again drowning in our narcissism, drowning in our own extravagance, in our own neglect, in our own heedlessness, as if we have never seen what we have seen. SubhanAllah, as that picture of that young boy whose name is Umran. And it's amazing because Umran in the Arabic language actually means that which builds, that which is used to build. Children like Umran, as his name suggests, are supposed to be our future. They are supposed to have a healthy future assured for them. They are supposed to grow up with education, with shelter, with safety, with family, recognizing that they have just as fair of a chance as any other child in the world at bettering their own situation and bettering the situation of their world as well. But subhanAllah, Umran represents an entire generation of Syrian children, a lost generation, a generation that's been completely neglected. And there's a certain cruelty and an eeriness that comes with this idea that in this day and age, someone simply presses a button and a bomb is launched thousands of miles away, and hundreds and thousands of lives are destroyed forever, while that person who pressed that button will never see the faces of his victim. It's a certain cruelty that the Prophet ﷺ spoke about, al-haraj, where there's just mass murder, mass killing, collateral damage if you want, carpet bombing, as some of our presidential candidates would have called it, that people in large numbers would die. And more and more and more are those people children, young people who had nothing to do with the conflict, who didn't even understand the conflict that they were born into. And subhanAllah, since World War II, that has been the trend, that the majority of the victims of war, the majority of civilians, are children. And if you think about what that means for a moment, it represents a failure of our entire generation. It represents a failure of our so-called advanced humanity that we have today. That the youngest of us are most likely to be our victims. And subhanAllah, as one political scientist expressed, that a young person, a young man could be sitting with a bag of chips and a bottle of Coke next to him in Nevada, pressing a button, and with that button, a wedding in Yemen is destroyed. Drone strikes from this country are employed, and thousands and thousands and thousands of innocent people have their lives ruined forever. Now for us, a group of people that left from this community and from other communities on a humanitarian trip, that picture of Umran meant something else. SubhanAllah, we had just come back from seeing the little Syrian children at the border of Jordan, 1 mile away from where their parents used to call home, because many of those children, like Umran, were actually born into the crisis. They don't even remember what normalcy is like. To them, this is their normal. The shock and the emotion at seeing this young child who was seemingly numb to everything around him is something that all of us had experienced. The children that we had seen more death in their lives than they had life. They've never been to schools. Most of them couldn't read or write. In fact, subhanAllah, most of them could not even recite Surah Al-Fatiha. They could not even recite any Qur'an. They don't know what school is like. Completely deprived of education and deprived of a future. And you wonder, what comes out of that? And what's our responsibility towards them? And I can tell you that, subhanAllah, if you're feeling hopeless when you see those images, it's a whole nother degree when you actually expose yourself to that in person. When you actually see those children in person. Because we knew that after we played with them and laughed with them and smiled with them and gave them these cheap toys that meant the world to them, that our children in this country would probably throw away within an hour or would probably laugh at. We knew that we would get back on our planes and we would head back home and we could pretend like we did not just see the world that we saw. Just like what we do over here, you just simply stop watching the news or something else goes viral now. We could also move on with our lives and pretend that we did not just see the most horrific situation and humanitarian crisis that we'd ever seen in our lives. And subhanAllah, it's interesting because when Syria first happened, and we shouldn't call it a civil war because it's not a civil war, when a tyrant started to butcher his own people, and the world was suddenly on fire, crying for Syria, you could see the effects of those NGOs that were there 3-4 years ago that are no longer there. And it's very much so representative of the situation, that people are not there anymore. And you wonder, what should I be doing? What should I be doing? What is my responsibility towards them? What's my excuse in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the Day of Judgment? And that brings me to a hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam outlined the responsibilities of the believer to his brothers and sisters around the world. Abu Dharr al-Ghifari radiallahu ta'ala anhu said that, I said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Ya Rasulullah, ماذا ينجي العبد من النار? O Messenger of Allah, what is it that causes a person to be protected from hellfire? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, الإيمان بالله, faith in Allah. You need to have faith in God. He said, قلت يا رسول الله, أإنما الإيمان عملا? I said to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, are there actions that accompany faith? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, يرضخ مما رزقه الله. He should spend from what Allah gave to him. There is enough money in the world to where if it was allocated properly, not a single person in the world would be in need of charity or zakah. We live in a world where people die of hunger, but there is enough food in the world to where each and every single member of the human race could have a 3,000 calorie diet. More than enough. In fact, the resources in the Muslim world alone, in the oil-rich countries of this ummah alone, would be enough not just to protect the Muslim world from hunger and poverty, but to protect the entire world from hunger and poverty. But guess what? That's not happening. But if you are one of those people who belongs to that class of elite people, where you could write a check, and you could literally solve the problems of people all over the world, you have a responsibility. Allah gave you that money as an amana. Don't kid yourself into thinking that you can just write your spare change off and call that your charity and think that's your responsibility to the world and that's all that Allah wants from you. You've got to do more. That's an amana. That's a trust. Allah is testing you with that ease just as He's testing them with that hardship. So يَا رَضَخْ مِمَّا رَزَقَهُ اللَّهُ. When you have the money, you spend it. But Shaykh, how long are we going to spend it for? How long are we going to keep giving charity for? When does it end? It seems like we just keep writing checks. How many Syria fundraisers are we going to have to go to? As long as you are capable of going to those fundraisers, and as long as you're capable of seeing that destruction and still being in a place where you can contribute, you still have to contribute. Even if it goes another 5-10 years, you still have to contribute. It's not like you get to write that check for 1, 2, 3 years and say it's over. You have a responsibility, not just to them, but to people all over. To those that are less fortunate all over. If you're in that place of privilege, act like you care for those that aren't. يَرْضَخْ مِمَّا رَزَقَهُ اللَّهِ. He said, قُلْتُ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ أَرَأَيْتَ إِنْ كَانَ فَقِيرًا. I said, O Messenger of Allah, what if he's poor and he doesn't have any money to give? The Prophet ﷺ said, يَأْمُرْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَى عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. He should enjoin that which is good and forbid that which is evil. Speaking is free. Enjoining good is free. Forbidding evil is free. Using your influence is free. And for better or worse, suddenly the entire world has a pulpit now. People that have no business having an opinion have an opinion now. And they have a place to amplify that opinion. And people that have something to say that is logical, that is rational, that is spreading awareness, often don't use the means that they have. So use what you've been given of influence then to change the situations that lead to the crises that continue to demand perpetual charity. Use what you have. If you have a sphere of influence that covers 3 people, use it. If you have a sphere of influence that covers 3,000 people, use it. And if your sphere of influence covers 3 million people, use it. Allah will not ask the one who has 3 about 3 million, but He will ask them about 3. And Allah will ask that person who has 3 million about his 3 million. Allah will ask you about your sphere of influence. Use it. What's stopping you? يَأْمُرْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَى عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. Is it fear? Is it cowardice? What is it that's stopping you from using what you have, the tongue that you have? Because the Prophet ﷺ said, مَنْ رَأَى مِنْكُمْ مُنْكَرْ فَلْيُغَيِّرْهُ بِيَدِهِ. Whoever amongst you sees evil, if he can change it with his hand, change it with his hand. If he can't do so, فَبِلِسَانِهِ. Let him speak out. Let him say something. Use your tongue that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you. قَالَ قُلْتُ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. I said to the Messenger of Allah, what if that person is a person who has no influence in society? What if that person is someone that can't do anything? What if that person can't change anything? Not with money or with position or with influence. The Prophet ﷺ said, يَصْنَعُ لِأَخْرَقْ. Let him go and educate someone who can. Find someone who's in a position to make a change and educate them so that they can make that change. You don't always have to be on the pulpit. You don't always have to be the policy maker. How often do we sit around and whine about what people in power are not doing? What are you doing to get to those people of power so that they can do things differently? I understand there are mass conspiracies, and I understand that the world seems to work in 2 different ways, the way that we see it and the world of WikiLeaks and whatever it may be. But those people that are in influence, those people that are in power that you keep on complaining about, what are you doing to get in their ear? What are you saying to them? Didn't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mention to us a group of Bani Israel who there was one group that was doing evil, one group One group that said they're hopeless, and one group that said, you know what, we're going to tell them anyway. We're going to try to change them anyway. مَعْذِرَةً إِلَىٰ رَبِّكُمْ As an excuse before Allah. And maybe, just maybe, we'll be able to influence it a little bit. Maybe we'll change them a little bit. Maybe we'll stop them a little bit. Maybe there is change in them. Maybe there is hope in them. Maybe. I might be able to make my mark in some way. Or I might not even influence the one who's in influence. But I will influence a person who can reach the one who's in influence. But maybe, ma'zira, it's just an excuse before Allah that I tried. I'm trying to reach them. And I'm saying what I have to say. Allah will not charge me, just as He does not with da'wah, with my call to Him. Allah will not charge me for how a person responds, but He will hold me accountable for whether or not I've spoken. يَصْنَعُ لِأَخْرَقْ Go and try to educate those people that are an influence. Go and try to, in a political realm, the sharh of this hadith would literally mean, try to reach policymakers and change them. Reach people of influence so that they can change their ways. Make your excuse before Allah. Ya Rasulullah, ara'aita in kana akhraq? He said, O Messenger of Allah, what if he himself is ignorant? What if he himself doesn't have that capacity, doesn't have that access? What does he do? The Prophet ﷺ said, yu'inu mazluma. And in one riwayah, yu'inu maghluba. That he will stand with the one who's being oppressed. If I can't change the situation that continues to yield oppression, that continues to create this vicious cycle to where there are so many more children whose pictures never get out there. So many more children that we'll never hear about. So many more children whose names we will never know. So many tents that will never be photographed or reached by an NGO. So many people that will be bombed in silence and that will die in silence without the world ever knowing their name. But if I can't change that situation, then at least I need to stand with those refugees. I need to stand with those that are being oppressed. I need to show them that we still remember you. If the world has forgotten you, we have not. If the world has turned its back on you, we have not. We're still here. I still care about you. Your plight is still my plight. I didn't sign up to walk with you for a year or two. I signed up to walk with you for your entire existence and as long as I continue to exist. You're just as precious to me as any other child. You are family. I'm here for you. There are refugees in Dallas, Texas. Refugees in Dallas, Texas. And I don't care which agency you go through, but you could easily reach them. And you could go and you could smile at them. And you could financially assist them. And you could take their family out to the park. And you could give them some level of normalcy. I'm not asking everybody to go see the refugees overseas. Though it's a life-changing experience. I'm saying right here, just go to them. Smile at them. Spend time with them. Give them some normalcy. Because you know what? There was a time where they used to take their children out to the parks in Syria, and they never imagined being in a situation like this. Acquaint yourself with them. يُعِينُ مَظْلُومًا I'm here for you. مَغْلُوبًا is someone who's defeated, meaning he's done. There is no way for that person to attain victory. It's over. But I'm here for you. I couldn't change the cycle, but I can still be here for you. That's my last excuse before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he said that, Abu Dharr said, Ya Rasulullah, what if he himself is mazloom? He himself is oppressed. لا يستطيع أن يصنع شيئا. He can't do any of those things. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Ya Abu Dharr, ما تريد أن تترك لصاحبك من خير? You don't want to leave any form of good for this person to do. ليمسك أذاه عن الناس. Let him withhold his harm from the people. If he can't do any good, let him withhold his harm from the people. قلت يا رسول الله إذا فعل ذلك دخل الجنة I said, O Messenger of Allah, if he does that, will he enter paradise? The Prophet ﷺ said, ما من مؤمن يطلب خصلة من هذه الخصال إلا أخذت بيده يوم القيامة حتى تدخله الجنة. Prophet ﷺ said that there is not a single believer that does any one of the things that have been mentioned above, except that it will take him from his hand on the day of judgment until it enters him into paradise. Dear brothers and sisters, what I learned on this trip And I already knew this, and I think a lot of us do. But subhanAllah, one of the most stunning realizations, I think, that if you ask anyone that's exposed themselves to these refugees, and we'll have time to talk about it on Saturday night, inshallah, is that they don't just expect us to keep sending charity their way, they expect us to be their voice. They expect us to lobby for them. They expect us to speak for them. They expect us to expose their story to the world. You know, subhanAllah, I've had the opportunity to work with disaster victims before. I have never seen more people that are more willing to get in front of a camera and tell their story than those Syrian refugees. Why? Because they feel like no one's heard them for 5 years. They're willing. You don't even have to ask them. They see the camera, they want to tell their story. They want the world to hear what they've gone through. Not as a complaint, but because you're here in a place of privilege. You should be doing something about this. I should be doing something about this. Charity is good, but we need to take it further. And each one of us needs to work in accordance with their capacity and really dedicate ourselves to that cause. Find our role in alleviating the suffering of them. And if we completely fail at doing so, and all the yelling and screaming and petitioning and all that yields absolutely no results, ma'adhiratan ila rabbikum. At least it's an excuse before Allah. Dear brothers and sisters, tonight bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, Muslim American leaders around the country are going to launch a campaign called No Fly Now, to put pressure on policymakers to enforce a no-fly zone over Syria, so that these airstrikes would stop, so that these people can live, can start to regain some sort of normalcy. Does it solve the problem? No, it does not solve the problem. But it's something. It's something. And so I want to invite everyone, inshallah ta'ala, to actually think about this. How to be a part of No-Fly Now, how to actually put pressure, how to lobby, how to write letters, how to play your part, inshaAllah ta'ala, while also petitioning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at night in your nightly prayers, in your tahajjud, in your qiyam al-layl, and while also continuing to give your charity, and continuing to meet with these refugees, and continuing to be a part of this. This part of the hadith is yasna'u li akhraq. We need to get in their ears and get in their faces and say, we're not going to wait for another Syrian child's image washed up on the coast of some resort to appear. We're not going to wait for another Umran. We're going to say something about this. And we're going to be their voice because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mandated it from us. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to be their voice, to forgive us for our neglect of them. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give them victory over their oppressors. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to return them to their homes in safety and in victory. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to elevate their ranks. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant them the best of this world and the next. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept their dead as martyrs and to cure their living. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to use us for them. Allahumma ameen. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum wa nisa' al-muslimin fastaghfiru innahu huwal ghafurur rahim. الحمد لله رب العالمين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين والعاقبة للمتقين اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على عبدك ورسولك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. Dear brothers and sisters, inshallah ta'ala, tomorrow night the youth from this community that had the opportunity to go on that humanitarian trip, inshallah ta'ala, will be sharing their stories. I want you to bring your families, bring your kids. I typically don't make announcements in the khutbah. I'm doing it now. Bring your children tomorrow night, inshallah ta'ala. Let them listen to youth who have been exposed to that, inshallah ta'ala. We need to awaken our hearts and awaken our conscience. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from us, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala elevate them and elevate us, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with them and be pleased with us. Allahumma ighfir lil mu'minina wal mu'minat wal muslimina wal muslimat al ahya'i minhum wal amwat innaka sami'un qareebun mujibud da'wat. Allahumma ighfir lana warhamna wa'fu 'anna wa la tu'adhibna. ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكوننا من الخاسرين. اللهم إنك عفو كريم تحب العفو فاعف عنا. اللهم اغفر لوالدينا، رب ارحمهما كما ربونا صغارا. ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. اللهم انصر المستضعفين في مشارق الأرض ومغاربها. اللهم انصر المستضعفين في مشارق الأرض ومغاربها. اللهم أهلك الظالمين بالظالمين وأخرجنا وإخواننا من بينهم سالمين. عباد الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. فاذكروا الله يذكركم واشكروه على نعمائه يزد لكم، ولذكر الله أكبر، والله يعلم ما تصنعون. وأقم الصلاة.
أشهد أن محمد